Okay, are we ready to start? Here we go, let's have a word of prayer before we get started today.
Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the privilege of coming in and teaching others your word. And Lord, we just ask that you be with us as we do this, that everybody will understand what your word has to say. And Lord, we just thank you for the many blessings of life that we enjoy each and every day as Americans. And we pray for this great nation. And we ask that it humble itself, repent, and turn back to you. And Lord, just whatever we do each and every day, Lord, may we always remember that you're in charge and you will lead us down the path as we pay attention. And just forgive us of our many sins. Of course, in Christ's name I ask this day. Amen.
Amen.
Carol wants to kind of give you guys an update on the Christmas boxes and the progress with that. And so I'm going to turn it over to her to make a few announcements and talk to y'all and all that. And she'll explain.
I thought maybe if I was going through this, that maybe you don't really know what you can't put in the box. So I'm going to tell you what you do not put in the boxes. Candy, toothpaste, gum, used or damaged items, scary or war-related items, seeds, food, liquids or lotions, medications or vitamins, breakable items, and glass containers and aerosol cans. Those are just suggestions. If you give them, they will not put them in a box. Because these are sent overseas. And with a lot of the liquids, there are dates when you can't, you know, when they expire and everything. Well, if you would put it in the box and it got there, the kids could not use it. And then I've had some people bring some stuff for items like kerchiefs, anything that a child would want or could play with. And this is another one. It's a washcloth and then it has a bar of soap. And I have toothbrushes, anything that a child could play with or learn from. These go to children that aren't as fortunate as our American children. And you know, there's a lot of cases that American children are in need of things too. But these go overseas. And they're in this box. And I've been keeping track. I had 5 donations. And that will go. And then I can box this up and Pete will take it. And just get it just so we can get it on its way. The deadline is November 12th, and that's next Sunday. Okay?
That's a hard deadline. We can't go past that. So I'll pick them up, and it's at the service. So I'll pick up the boxes next Sunday, and beyond that, we're done.
It's a good organization, and they, so what's it? 10,000 boxes last year that went?
Yeah, oh, more than that.
More
yeah.
than that.
They've done 180 million so far since they started.
So, and my number, my room number is 1115. And today, this was on my door, and it has socks and a bag of beads. Now, I don't know about you, but I might have jewelry that I don't use anymore. It's in good condition. It can go. You don't have to buy something. Just remember a kid and a smile. There's nothing like a kid's smile to warm your heart. And that's what this goes.
Can you have a couple of things?
We do. Each box has that list that she was reading from in it, but she was like, for if you're wanting to donate single items and stuff
you
like that.
You can donate money too. People will spend the money toward items and the shipping.
And if you want a box, she's got boxes too. She can give you.
I've got 3 extra boxes. I gave out 5 this week. toys. You can, like, toy cars or jump ropes, yo-yos, soccer ball with a pump, a doll, a stuffed animal, shoes, anything that you can think of, maybe your grandchildren or your great-grandchildren. I don't think there's any children here, but these kids get this, and then you'll come in a box, and you don't have to pack the box, I don't have to pack the box. I just collect it and I turn it over to him, and he gets it through the organization.
They have a group of volunteers that will pack the box. If you don't, you know, if you're just doing single items.
So it's fun. It's worth the effort. And the church that I became a fan of this, we got letters back from the children. And when you give a cash, I don't know how much what you give. I just write down cash donation. So I don't. And please, if you leave it at my door, do not put the amount of money that you're donating in the envelope, because I don't want anybody to know. I don't even know. That's it.
Your number in your hymnal, 453, Lady on the Everlasting Arms, first and last verse.
Always makes a
to that day. Oh, Lazarus, what's his name? His loved ones wept, for death had crept into their lives with pain. Oh, but someone sent a message to Jesus, did reply. And even death, it could have no power when Jesus passes by.
Your pain.
but you're not alone. Jesus is with you. He feels your pain.
Sometimes don't diminish the reality of His presence. Darkness will fall and clouds will
that was our song this morning today. So in everything we have in life, even though we don't see a way, God will make a way.
Amen.
And one of the first times we see that in the Bible is when Moses and the Israelites were going down toward the Red Sea. And of course, Pharaoh's army and the Egyptians were behind them. And they got to the Red Sea, and everybody's thinking, so what are we going to do now? Okay? We can't get over this. So they're looking at Moses saying, why did you call us and bring us into this position? If all we're going to do now, and they see all Pharaoh and his army coming behind them, all you're going to do is get us killed. Okay? But who told Moses to lead the Israelites where they were going? God did. Okay? So God says, wait a minute, Moses, lift up your staff. And when he lifted up his staff out over the water, what happened to the Dead Sea, or Red Sea? It parted, okay? And the Jews went out and went across the Red Sea. All right, now here comes Pharaoh and his army and his chariots and everything. And you would think, you know, he figured he could just follow the Jews and everything would be fine. So what did God do? God let him come on in till he got in the middle, and then what did he do? He closed it all up again. So it killed all of Pharaoh's army, destroyed all his chariots and everything, and took Pharaoh out too. So did God solve the problem? Yes, he did. Did the Jews think he was going to do that? No, they figured they were doing all kind of problems. But Moses paid attention to what God said. He did what God said, and God did the rest. God made a way when they thought there was no way. Okay? And that's one of the first instances in the Bible when we talk about that. Now, one of the second instances is Joshua and the walls of Jericho. Okay? The Jews were keeping on. They were going into the promised land, okay? But when they were to go into the promised land, there were different things that they had to deal with, the different types of people that were living there, okay? And one of the first things they do is they come into Jericho. And Jericho was this huge walled city, okay? And the only way they found out what was going on in Jericho is they sent a couple of spies in there to look and see what's going on, and they were protected by a lady in there. Her name was Rahab the harlot, okay? And Rahab helped and protected them while they were in there trying to figure out what was going on. They climbed over the wall, and she protected them, everything. Well, when the Jews came around there and they looked at this big wall, they said, how are we going to fix this now? We can't get over the wall. The wall's so high, we can't destroy these people. So what we're going to do? You know, again, you would think that if everything has happened in the past and everything, they would know that God was going to fix the way. Okay? So what does God tell them to do? He says, okay, here's what I want you to do. He tells Joshua, have the people circle the city for 6 days. Okay? Have them walk around the city every time the same day, same time every day for 6 days. Okay? They walk around, you know, and I'm sure the Nazarites looking at them and saying, what in the world are they doing out here, you know? Do they think they can do anything to us by walking around the city? And so they didn't think nothing was going to happen. But God told him on the seventh day, he said, I want you to walk around again. He said, this time, I want you to blow the trumpet, and I want you to start singing for joy as you go around the city. So they followed God's advice, and as they did it, guess what happened? The walls came tumbling down, okay? So God took the walls out, and he told the Jews to go in there, and he said, kill everybody in the city except Rahab and her family. You're to totally destroy the city, all the animals, everything. So that's what they did. They totally destroyed Nazareth and everything else. So
So that's what happened the second time. But the Jews were still looking at the Lord and saying, what's going on? Why do we do this? Why does it happen this way? But what did the Lord tell Joshua when he first got in? When he started questioning different things, he told Joshua, he said, be strong. And he said, and I'll be good courage, because the Lord is with thee, and I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Okay? So when we know that God is with us, he will never leave us nor forsake us, no matter where we're at.
Amen.
Okay? And I can remember this as a very true fact when I went on Desert Storm. And I landed there at 2:30 in the morning, and I look over at the young Air Force guy that's with me, and I said, what is the temperature? And he said, it's 126 degrees. He said, well, just wait till tomorrow. It'll be 135. So I'm thinking to myself, uh-oh, what have I gotten myself into now? Okay? And you look out around you, and at night over there, there's no trees or nothing, so there's nothing you can see. And it's so dark, you can't even see your hand in front of your face. Okay? So you know you're in trouble with a capital P. Because we never have seen anything like that. So I could understand what the Jews were seeing sometimes when they were expecting things to happen and God to do things, but they didn't actually believe he would do it. Okay? Now, the third time we're going to talk about here is David and Goliath. I mean, most of us remember the story about David and Goliath, okay? Now, David was this young kid, okay? He was a young kid, and he had his brothers were down with the Israeli army, and they were fighting the Philistines. So David said, his father told him, go take some food to your brothers while they're fighting, okay? Well, the Jews at that time were fighting the Philistines, okay? Now, the Philistines had Goliath. Now, Goliath was this giant. He was 13 feet and a half tall. That's a pretty big guy, if you want to look at it that way. And he had all this armor and everything, this body armor he had was so heavy and everything, I'm sure that it would take four or five of us just to carry the rank. But he had all this on the battlefield with him. And he would come out every day and he would harass the Israelites and their army. Well, when here comes David out there, and David says, you know, he's watching, he says, why aren't y'all doing anything about this guy? And he said, I'd like to go out there and help you and see if I couldn't get rid of him. Now here you got this young teenager coming out there on the battlefield, and you see this big, huge giant. And he says, I can take care of him. And of course, everybody's going to look at him like he's what? He's crazy with a capital C, okay? But David, first thing says, I can take care of him because with God's help, I already killed a lion and a bear who tried to attack me, okay? And God had helped him kill these two animals, okay? How many of you think you would like to kill a bear or a lion, and all you got is a slingshot to help you do it? I don't think I'd be that good at that, you know, because you got to know what you're doing with a slingshot to do something. Well, David had his slingshot and five stones. So he goes out there to take on Goliath, and of course, who was with him while he was doing this? The good Lord, of course, was with him.
Yeah.
He allowed David to take his little slingshot he had there, put a stone in there, and sling it and hit Goliath right between his eyes. Okay? And it killed him. Okay? And of course, when this happened, everybody looked like this. How could he do this? Well, then David runs up there and takes Goliath's sword out from him and cuts his head off.
Yeah.
Picks his head up and says, yes, I did it. With God's help, I took care of him. So it scared the Philistine army so bad that, of course, the Israelites ended up going around and beating them on the battlefield that day. Okay?
But God made this way for David to do what he did with Goliath. And God didn't question, or David didn't question how he was going to do it. He just knew that God was going to be with him and he would take care of him. Okay? He didn't question him. And he didn't think, well, just because he's 13 and a half foot tall, I can handle him. No big deal. Because I handle that lion and that bear. So David, with God's protection, would take care of probably one of the largest men in human history. Okay? And he took care of it all. Now, then the last situation we have to talk about today was Elijah and Elisha. Now, Elijah was one of the greatest prophets that's ever been, you know, in the Old Testament. Okay? And Elijah, when he was getting ready to stop being a prophet, he picked up Elisha. God told him to take Elisha and teach him how to be a prophet, and then he would take up for him. Well, one of the things about Elisha was that he told, you know, Elijah told him what he was going to have to do and everything, and of course, you know, he didn't think much of that until he followed Elijah around a couple of times. And right before Elijah would be taken out of the world by God, he went with Elisha had to go with him to see what was up, because he told him, come on, I'm going to show you what we're going to do here. One of the first things he did, they went across the Jordan River, and he just threw out his cane there like normal. For some reason, the Jewish prophets in the Old Testament used their cane. I don't know if that's what we're supposed to do with our cane today, is just put it out there and God will take care of what's in front of us. But that's what the Old Testament guy did. Elijah put out his cane and crossed the Jordan River. Just walked across the Jordan River and had Elisha go with him. Well, when Elisha went with him, the first time, he saw this chariot of fire and everything else appear and everything. And he's looking there with Elijah and figuring out, what is going on here? Where did this chariot of fire come from and everything else? Well, the chariot of fire was brought there by Almighty God, and it was his way of taking Elijah to heaven. Okay? Because Elijah was one of two people in the Bible that never died. Okay? The first, I don't know how many of you remember, but he's one of the oldest men in the world. Enoch was the first one. He was taken up by God. It just says he was taken out. Okay? The God took him out. So we don't know how he died, what happened to him, everything. We just know he was taken out. Well, Elijah, though, he had this flaming chariot come in for him and picked him up and takes him back to heaven. Okay? He didn't die. And you know what the Bible always has told us is appointed a man, what? Once to die, and then the what? Then the judgment. Okay? So, one of our questions should be here, is why did God let Enoch live? Why did he let Elijah live? Okay? But we have no way of knowing exactly what it's for, but we have reason to believe that we might know what he took them out for, like what? Because he may return them to the earth, yeah. What time? When? During the tribulation period. When the two tribulation period, there'll be one of the two people that will return to the earth, and the people who were on the earth at that time will be able to see them, and they'll be doing different things. And we think it's those two because they have never died. So God could return here, and then they can do whatever they had to do. And if they got killed at that time, wouldn't be no big deal, would it? Because God is putting them here to do whatever he wants them to do. So that's some of the four stories that I have in the Bible about God making a way to do certain things. Because we see there were so many things we didn't think could happen, but because God was around, he let his servants do what they needed to do. Not necessarily what they wanted to do always, Because we have to remember one thing. God's will and our will is not the same thing. Because God knows everything that needs to happen on the face of this earth. And we don't have a clue what needs to happen. We think we do. We think, okay, today I got to do this, I got to do that, I can go here, I can go that, there. But do you really know you're in charge? No. Because something can happen to you in the morning and you'll never get this done or whatever. So God always makes a way when it's up to Him to make a way where we need to be. Okay? Do we know where we need to be? No. We think we do. But we don't know for sure. But God will put us where He wants us to be. And that's one of the reasons why I always thought so much of this, because we find ourselves in situations and we tell ourselves, well, I can handle this. This is no problem. I can do this. I can do that. I can do this. But then we get in the middle of the situation and nothing has turned up the way we expected it, and we got to look up and say, uh-oh, Lord, would you please fix this? Because I can. And that's what we need to remember each and every day. God will make a way when there seems to be no way. And as long as we understand He's in charge and we're just here, because number one, who put us here? He did. He put us here. He's got a reason for putting us here. Okay? Maybe He wants us to spread His word. Maybe He wants us to do this or do that. Or maybe He wants us to fill boxes so we can send them all over the world to children. Whatever it is, God has a purpose for what we do, okay?
Amen.
And as long as we can remember that, we will never get ourselves in trouble, okay? Because He will always be in charge of our lives and everything we do. So remember it each and every day when you go to the Lord in prayer. So, Lord, just help me to remember that You're in charge and I'm not in charge. And whatever You have, You want me to do, just show me the way, and I'll be more than happy to follow that way. Okay? And as long as we follow God's way, we won't get in any trouble.
Amen.
Okay? And that's my lesson for today.
Awesome.
And I thank you very much for the privilege to come here and give you that lesson.
Well, thank you so much, because that is an excellent lesson. And you know, something you said, I think, is we take for granted, and we don't realize or don't think about it, I don't think, a lot of times, that we're placed here, as you said, for a purpose. Each one of us has a part in God's plan. Now, you may be a small part, you may be a large part of God's plan, but each of us has a part in God's plan, but it's up to us to do what He has us here to do, and I think a lot of times we don't think of that. We don't realize, too, we're privileged to be here now. Because I do think anybody that you want to ask is going to tell you, we are watching things occur that are biblical. And to have the opportunity to be here to watch it and see it happen with our own eyes. There are prophets way, way back that would have, you know, loved to be here right now to see all these things that are being enacted and happen that we see written in the Bible. They would love to watch what you and I are privileged enough to be here and see. But that also tells me that God wants me here for a purpose. And that humbles me to know that God could use me at such a time as this. Because it's not easy, guys. This is one of the hardest times in history to live for a Christian. And so, you know, it humbles me to know that I'm here and I'm part of God's plan. And I thank God every day that He placed me here now with His wisdom to know that this is when He thought I'd be most effective for Him. And I thank Him for that, you know, for that confidence that He has in me. And I hope I live up to it. I hope I live up to what He expected me to do. I hope we all do, right? So let's pray. Again, thank you. Awesome message, Chip. Let's pray. And does anybody have any prayer requests? I'm sharing my phone so I can take it to my body. Does anybody have any prayer requests we need to add to our list?
Well, I guess it's on your list to pray for my son and my son-in-law.
Yep, they're on here.
My son keeps falling, and he's going to be coming here for a visit with, to stay with my daughter.
Oh, okay.
And his mind is like
Sure. Well, if you get an opportunity, bring him, you know, during one of the services, we can meet him. Well, this person we've been praying for, that'd be nice.
That'd be wonderful. Yeah. But I just have to pray that he has enough mind and heart to be saved.
Yeah.
And Tom, with this cancer, the drug that the doctor wants to use has not been approved yet by the insurance.
Okay.
And Tom is in a lot of pain.
Right. Okay, so we'll pray for Tom's pain as well. How about that? Let me put that in here. Any updates other than that on them? No. Okay. All right. And of course, we've got Bob on our list right here. But continue to keep Bob on your prayer list. He's going this week, isn't it? This week? Going this week to have the scope done. They're going to look in his heart with a little camera. And plan, basically. This is a planning session to see what's next. You know, for the hole in his heart, they're going to ultimately have to patch it, obviously. But they're going to, you know, plan it out with this first surgery and then go from there. Carol, you had some health issues last week. Did you need us to pray for anything for you?
I just want to thank God that I am here.
There you go. No doubt, right? Every day is another day. Another opportunity to serve the Lord, yes. And of course, we've got Thelma Adams, and I know the lady that normally tells me about her isn't here today. Anybody else know how Thelma's doing, or any word on Thelma Adams?
She's doing very well. She'll be back this month.
She will be back. Okay, good. Well, let's keep her in our prayers that she does come back, and all that worked out. Pat England and Bridget, any word on them?
That's my sister, Lynn, and my dear friend here, aggressive cancer, been losing one arm and one shoulder, going around.
Yeah. Getting worse or not?
Yeah, she's going through a lot.
Okay. So we'll keep them in our prayers as well. Any others that we need to add? Yeah.
Please let's keep prayers for what's going on in Israel.
Of course.
Yeah.
That one's top on my list, yeah.
The innocent people that are caught in the middle of this.
And unfortunately, you know, pray also that people have discernment and understanding for that, because there's so much garbage right now being spread, so much misinformation. We live in a world, you know, one of the things that Jesus told us that during the last days, one of the hardest things that we're going to face is all the deception. Of these days, and we're watching that. I mean, you can't turn on a TV without five lies hitting you in the face. So watch for deception. Don't be deceived by it. Stay in the Word of God, and you will have the truth instead of the deception.
When I watch and see the little innocent children saying, "What have I done?" You know, all bloody and everything over there. My heart just breaks for them, you know?
Sure.
It's awful.
It is. All of it. Unfortunately, as Chip had mentioned, everything has a purpose. Even those deaths serve a purpose. You know, the song that he played, God Will Make a Way, if you think about it, that song has inspired so many people to give their life to the Lord, right? When they were in such a hard place. And so you think about the fact that those deaths inspired him to write that music, which then in turn may have saved how many lives? So, yes, it cost those children their lives, but it saved so many others, too. So even though we may not get it, we may not understand it, God's always working. Even in our biggest tragedy, God is there, and he's making it for our good. Everything is for our good, even when we don't see it. But yes, we should always pray for those that are less fortunate, always pray for those that are in pain. You know, nobody wants to be in pain, the innocent especially. We can't change what we can't change. I wish we could. We have peace throughout the world. But definitely keep Israel in your prayers. Keep the innocent in your prayers. Any others? Okay. All right. Let's all bow our heads and we'll start our prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you again for another day, Lord. Thank you for another day here. Thank you for the privilege, the honor of being here during this time to see things that prophets would have loved to be here to see, but they spoke of 2,000 years ago, they said would happen, and we're actually watching it happen right before our eyes. And those prophets wrote those words, Father. Thank you for letting me be the one that watches them occur. Now, Lord, we thank you for another day. We thank you here for Chip's message, reminding us that we're not you. And as much as we may want to think we can decide our life and make things better and work out our own plan, thank God you don't let us. Because I'm sure if it was my plan, it would burn up anyway. So, Lord, thank you for not allowing me what I would want, and that is my own way. Because my own way is not the right way. Your way is the right way. So, Father, thank you for doing what is best for me rather than what I say I want. And, Lord, continue to do your work in this earth. Continue to make your will the will of everyone, Father. Continue to use me as your servant, Lord, for each and every day. Give me new tasks to perform for you, Lord. Let me always be shining your light in my life, Father. Let me be the mirror for your grace, your beauty. And Lord, let me not dirty that mirror with my own sins and my own weaknesses, Father. Continue to cleanse me, Lord. Continue to make me holy and better, more like you each day. Father, we have several people on our list that we want to pray for. Lord, of course, we pray for all the innocents throughout the world. Everyone who is suffering because of the wickedness of men. Father, we ask that you would, if they must perish, Father, we ask that you do it swiftly and you do it without pain for those who are innocent, Father. We do ask, Lord, that you would help these people to come to peace, Father, that they might put down their arms and embrace each other as joyous brothers and sisters rather than enemies. Father, even though we know your word says that won't happen, Lord, that's still our prayer, that one day there can be peace. And we do know that when you come, the Prince of Peace, there will be peace, Father, because all knees will bow. All men will bow before you and give you peace, Father. So come. Please come, Lord. Soon. Take all of this wicked away. Lord, we pray for Richard and Tom. And we pray for Tom's salvation as much as we do for his health, Father. We would ask that Richard would get better. We ask that Tom be able to visit us, Father. And that when he visits, we might be able to make a change in his life and help him see the truth, Father. We do hope that the new insurance or that the insurance would approve the medication that he needs, Father. I know that's in your hands, Lord. Let him reach out to you, Father, and ask you for this, Lord, so that you might begin to work in his life. Lord, put someone in his life that will talk to him about you, Father, that will lead him to you, so that he begins to ask for you in his life. Lord, we hold up to you, Bob, and all of the things going on with his heart. We ask that you would watch over him this week as he has the procedure done. That you would be there with him, Father, and guide the surgeon's hands so that they would do exactly what they need to do to figure out what he needs to be healthy. Father, we ask that you would continue to watch over Bob, and when he has the surgery, that they would patch the hole and do it with the precision of your hands, Father, rather than theirs. Lord, we ask that Jim, the resident here, would continue to get well. We ask that Thelma Adams, after her stroke, would return to all of us here, her family here at Harmony, and that she would continue to get better. Father, we hold up to you Pat England and Bridget, who both had cancer, Pat in England, and Bridget, who had cancer. And Lord, we ask that you would help them, Father, help them spiritually to bring you more into their life and help them with their health. And finally, Father, I hold up to you everyone here at the Harmony facility. Lord, we ask that you would bless each and every one of them as they take care of all the people here. And that, Lord, you would help them push and to point everyone to you, Father. Lord, we ask all of these things in your Son's precious name. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys. Wonderful service. Thank you again for all being here. And, of course, if anybody needs us, needs to talk, we're here. I always stay a few extra minutes. I'd love to talk to you if you want to pray. We can pray if you want to call me later and pray. We do that, too. I'm here for you. You're my brothers and sisters. Yeah, we're going to do that. You're my brothers and sisters, and so I want you to know I'm always here for you, okay? So last, as we always do, we want to do a hymn. Now, I have a request, so we're going to see. I'm going to ask Donna if she knows it. But we're going to do Amazing Grace now, and we'll see if we can do that request at the end after that. All right? As we always do, 204. Thank you again, Chip. And Donna, let's give Donna a hand. She is wonderful.